Greetings, I am Herbert Erpaderp, and today I'm continuing to work on my Australian Matilda, which is my part of the Commonwealth Buddy Build with Model Minutes and Nomad Productions. As before, I will include a link to those guys in the description below, as well as my previous Buddy Build video, in which I did the majority of the work on this model. If you've not seen those videos, I would suggest starting there. Today, the Australianisation, which is a word now. That is to say, I'm adding some photo etch and a couple of pieces of resin. If you've seen the previous video, you've already seen how it ends up looking, but why not share how it got there? Let's get right into it. The photo etch I used is this set of Marsden matte deck covering. This is from Firestorm Miniatures, though the part itself says Edward. No idea what's going on there, but I don't suppose it matters all that much. As far as photo etch goes, this stuff is fairly simple. I start by installing the support brackets. The instruction sheet that came with this set gives you an idea of where these parts should be installed. Of course, being a very thin piece, it's kind of hard to get it to stand up vertically, but I got there in the end. The two shorter parts go on the top of the engine deck, while the longer ones sit on the sloped section. The longer parts also have one longer leg, which should go towards the rear. For those who would prefer not to use these supports, the piece of wire you would have seen in the package can be bent into shape and used instead of these. If doing that, I would suggest that you could drill holes to mount it, and it would probably be quite a bit stronger than the supports I used, though I don't think it would look quite as good. Then come the pieces of Marsden mat. These were actually used as pieces of temporary runway, though quite often repurposed for a lot of other things too. Anyway, these have locking tabs, I guess you might call them, down the length of each piece. The idea being that you bend them to a 90 degree angle and then they link together. That seemed like a lot of work, so what I did was to link the parts together and then use the handle of my knife to press and bend the parts such that they should stay together. This is a lot quicker than I imagined bending all of those parts would be, especially since I don't have a tool that could do all the bending in one go. I applied some super glue to the underside to make sure that it will all stay together. The instruction sheet shows how these parts should go together, and they are all pretty much the same except for the end parts, with the obvious cutout for the turret at one end, and two cutouts for the fuel tank mounts at the other. I glue those assemblies onto the tank, though it was a little bit fiddly considering how thin the supports are. A little bit of weight on these helps, but I wouldn't go too heavy for what I think are obvious reasons. These little angled parts are intended to go here under the sloped section, though on the left this will interfere with a resin part I intended to use, which I think was an infantry phone. This looks interesting too, so I'm not too upset. Also, I forgot to video the installation of the forward section of matting, but I think you get the idea. Moving right along, here are the two bags of resin bits. This is prior to cleanup, and you can see there's quite a bit of excess resin there. These were also from Firestorm, and included a different engine deck covering, a more meshy one. I obviously decided that the Marsden mats were more interesting. With these resin parts, I started out adding the parts that would make this stand out as the Australian Matilda, and then I followed with more general stowage. A few of these resin parts duplicate those included in the kit, like this roll tube thing. I think the resin one looks a bit more interesting than the plastic one, so onto the rear of the turret it goes. Obviously, because this is resin, I'm using superglue. Onto the turret's left side, I add this set of, I assume they're tarps or something to cover the tank. They're pretty big. You would have seen the plastic rack into which you would install the plastic version of this in the previous shot, but I removed it because, well, it was in the way. And the resin part seems to have the rack molded into the bottom of it anyway. Then I add a set of ammo boxes. These are where the antenna mount thing was previously, and I obviously removed that to get this into place. I'm not sure the Australian Matildas always had that antenna anyway, but I have seen pictures of them with boxes like this. I add a pair of steps for the rear of the tank. Initially, I thought these were just resin scraps, but the instructions informed me otherwise. I assume these are to make it easier for the infantry to climb up onto the engine deck for a fun ride. They were, as you might assume, a bit fiddly to get into place, but they do fit rather nicely when you get them there. I think this is an interesting little detail. Then I install the armored collar, for lack of better description, which goes around the turret. I assume there were issues with people shooting into the turret ring, which, to be fair, does sound quite annoying. The two front parts sit in place up against the slightly raised part on either side of the driver's hatch, and this is followed by the longer sections that go in behind like so. This was probably the worst part in this set. It broke when I was cleaning it up because it's so thin and fragile, and it hasn't really gone on very well. I'm definitely going to have to do some putty work around this. It is a very close fit with the turret, so it's obviously a good idea to make sure that it does in fact fit. I did have some trouble at first, but in the end it did fit. Then come the big shieldy things for the front of the tracks. Yep, that's the technical term. These big chonkers are to protect against the tank being tracked, which I've read was the most vulnerable part at the front of the Matilda, being that the Japanese guns weren't so effective against its heavy armour. The part goes on easily enough, and while you do have to eyeball it a bit, I think I've positioned it correctly. Next comes this little latch lock thing for the track guard. This is simple enough to nudge into place, and I like that it's a separate part. This will allow you to model the track guards in the up position if you so choose. Then the mounts or hinge parts or whatever you would like to call them for the shields go into place. I suppose you could try adding these before the shields, but that seems like a recipe for misaligned parts, and that's not a meal anybody wants. I suspect either way you do this is going to be a little bit fiddly, but it wasn't that bad and I managed to get them all into place without losing them. It was a close thing, but the floor monster, cousin to the turret monster, has gone unfed. Once that was done, I add these boxes. I'm not sure what these are, they look like they've got tarps or something inside of them, and I've read that on the flamethrower version of the Matilda there would be fuel tanks in this position, which seems like a pretty bad idea, but I don't think that's what these are. Whatever they are, I think they look quite good and add even more interest to the front of the tank. And that's all of the parts I considered important distinguishing features of the Australian Matilda. Now for some more general stowage. On the turret, I added this, I guess it's some stuff covered in a kind of messy looking tarp. I've no idea, I just thought it would look interesting here, and it did seem to fit. That's going to be the theme for pretty much all of these parts. I follow that with this neater looking roll behind the commander's cupola. I was careful to position these parts in a way that didn't obstruct the hatches. It seems like a bad idea to obstruct hatches. Onto the engine deck I glued this. I would call this the main piece of stowage. Seems like a good enough name for it. This looks really nice in my opinion, though it is a little bit wider than the Marsden mats, which I do find a bit distracting. I would imagine the ends of this should flop down and over the edge of the mat, but that isn't the case. I guess we could say that these are boards wrapped in tarps or something, which is helping keep this rigid. Moving on, after a little test fitting, I add this thing. More stuff wrapped in tarps or canvas, in what I thought was a good spot. Then, a box. I think this is an ammo tin. My method for putting this stuff onto the model was kind of long and ponderous. Just test fitting various bits and pieces, and then gluing them in place when I decided I liked how they looked. And you probably don't need to see me umming and ahhing over every single piece, though those who watched the build stream would have seen that. Whether or not that made for good viewing, I have no idea. At the front of the hull, I spent a bit of time considering putting a box on the front right to try and hide that armoured collar. That part in particular looks quite messy. While pondering, I added this tarpy roll-looking thing, which kind of looks as though it's just been tossed there haphazardly. I feel like that gives a used and lived-in look, for lack of better words. I tried a different box because why not, then ummed and ahed and decided that this long boy should go on the rear. I did rather enjoy this process. I found it fun to ponder why bits and pieces might be where they are. It was kind of like a puzzle. Of course, it does end up looking sort of random, but that's kind of the point, really. A good idea when doing something like this is to take care and make sure that the turret can still rotate. This will be important if you want to be able to take the turret off for painting. Fortunately, mine does rotate. Not a full 360 degrees, but enough that I can remove it. Eventually, I got all, well, not all, but all the stowage I wanted on, and it was time to add the final detail, this vise. I'm not sure how common it was to have a vise mounted on the side of your tank, but I thought it was very interesting, and I can see how it might be useful. I'm pretty happy with how this stowage has ended up. I wouldn't expect this to be the loader Matilda would take into battle. It's more like they've been told to move and quickly loaded, or rather thrown, all of their supplies onto the back of their tanks and moved out. Anyway, as you might have guessed, that's all of the building done for this model. The next step will be to fix a few bits and pieces with putty, and then it's time to start painting. Decals are on the way, which include some cool red stripes, you know, to make it go faster, and eventually you'll see a painting video for this tank. I am going to try and get it done pretty quickly, but I'm not a fast painter, so I would certainly advise against holding your breath. You will die. As I said, I'm quite happy with how this has turned out. It's an interesting tank in its own right, but the extra bits add quite a lot, and I feel like they're going to add some fun to the painting process too. Maybe a little bit of extra complexity, and it will surely make it take a bit longer, but I think it's going to be fun, and really, that's what matters to me. If you've been around my channel, you'll know that I'm not the biggest fan of resin, or superglue which you need to use to bond resin, but I did actually enjoy these resin bits. The cleanup was a bit annoying, especially cleaning up the armoured collars, which were the only parts I managed to break. Anyway, adding them to the model was quite fun, and I'm glad I chose to do so. I like that not all of these parts are super neat and tidy, like you often see in various bits of stowage that kits have. Perfect neat tarps and bags and such. These parts look a lot more used and realistic. The photo etch was pretty simple to use, which is not always the case with photo etch parts, but these were largely flat and only needed minimal bending. I did initially want to have quite a bit of the Marsden mats exposed and visible, and maybe I got a bit carried away with the stowage. Still, I think it looks good, and I guess that's a little bit less Marsden mat that I need to paint. You can still see some and it still gets the point across, so it was still a good idea to use it. The base kit was also pretty good. I didn't speak much about that the other week, though I guess maybe it speaks for itself. Not literally, that would be weird. It was a rather enjoyable build, though it did take quite a while because that's just how things go when you build models on stream and don't tend to do very long sessions. I can't think of any real issues I had with the model. It is a Tamiya kit and of course it's hard to go wrong with Tamiya. As usual, I've done most of this work on stream, all except for cleaning up the resin. And I'm sure that would have been some dull viewing anyway. Point is, if you would like to watch me build stuff live, head on over to twitch.tv/Herbert_Erpaderp or follow the link in the description below and give me a follow. You'll be notified when I go live. I've got some pretty cool stuff to work on stream, so come hang out and have a chat with myself and the good folks in the community. As I said earlier, this is part of the Commonwealth Buddy Build that I'm taking part in with Nomad Productions and Model Minutes. And I would like to encourage you to go and check out their projects as well. Nomad is building a Canadian Firefly, being that he's from Canada, and Model Minutes, being a Brit, is doing the British M3 Honey. Links will of course be in the description and the cards. If you have any questions or comments, those are more than welcome in the comment section below. And if you've not done so already, why not subscribe, follow, ring the bell, become a patron or YouTube member, or maybe just come and say hi on Discord or Twitch when I'm live. Links to all of my things are in the description below, and as always, I shall return soon. So until then, be excellent to each other, and thank you for watching. Farewell.